Jones. And this was a man who had clear and definitive beliefs about what was right theology and what was wrong theology. So this man, shortly after his conversion, was coming out of a theater in London. And what he did was he stopped and he saw a band playing. And this band was a Salvation Army band. And Martin Lloyd-Jones, theologically, is about as different from the Salvation Army as two Christian groups could be from each other. Martin Lloyd-Jones would have said the Salvation Army, you know, they believe wrongly about this, wrongly about that, wrongly about the other thing. But as he stood there and watched the band playing and listened to them play, he said to whoever was next to him, he said, "These are my people. This is my family." And as John Stott used to say, any friend of Jesus is a friend of mine. We are family, not just in here, but all over. Any friend of Jesus is a friend of mine, and I hope a friend of yours also. And so, after being threatened and harassed, they went back to their family. They went back, Peter and John did, to their own people. Peter and John, when they came back to their own people, gave a great report about success, but also of great danger and hostility. Because something good from God, this gospel being preached by these people, being lived out in this community of the Holy Spirit, was coming up against an opposing force, a force which intended on keeping people away from Jesus. What was happening in those early days was that the people of God were filled with the Spirit of God. And because they were filled and excited about Jesus, they could not keep God's presence to themselves. They burst out of their own community. It was like new wine being poured into old wineskins. It was like putting water in Tupperware in a freezer, or putting a Coke can in the freezer and just opening up, and it's burst out. It's overflowing. They burst out of their own community to share what they had. And what they found was a world, on the one hand, which on the one hand needed Christ, but which on the other hand was hostile to him. And so they're excited, they've got this faith, they've got the Holy Spirit, they've got this message, they've got this new community, the new family, they want to share it all with the world. So they go out, and what do they find? A world that's so needy and broken, but also a world that is hostile, that is resistant. And isn't our world the same way? Our world needs the love of Christ and the power of the Spirit so badly, but isn't it true that our world can actually be quite resistant to the idea of following Him, to the idea of trusting someone else with our life, with our salvation, with our future? When you and I are doing something that is right, but it's meeting with resistance, what's our response? What's our instinct? Well, if the Spirit of God is in us, then God's Spirit will cause us to pray. The Spirit of God will cause us to trust in God, to trust in God and not in ourselves at every crucial moment. And this is exactly what happened with the early church. You know, sometimes our reaction is, when things don't go our way, is panic, is worry, is anxiety. These are natural human reactions. But as the Spirit grows us more and more into maturity in Christ, and as the Spirit wells up in us, and as we practice this more and more, we find that our instincts change as we grow in Christ. That our instinct is less and less to panic and to worry and to be anxious and to be fretful, and more to say, okay, this is to be expected. I'm going to cast my lot with God. I'm going to trust in the Lord. And that's exactly what this young church did. You know, they weren't that mature in Christ yet. But the Scripture records here that they came together, they prayed, and they reinforced their faith in the Lord. One of the recurring storylines in the book of Acts is this three-way interaction between God the Holy Spirit, the believers in Christ, and the rest of the world. If you and I live our lives the way most people do today, then, as that old song tells us, it's just you and me against the world, isn't it? You and I out there alone, or maybe in the company of a couple other people, trying to find our way out there in that great big world all by ourselves. But for the believer in Christ, the Holy Spirit adds a huge X factor to just you and me against the world. All through the book of Acts, the Holy Spirit acts mightily in and through believers, followers of Jesus, like Peter and John. And in turn, believers like Peter and John trust in God's empowering presence as they sought to accomplish God's purposes out there in the world. And so it wasn't just these men of valor, these outstanding men. It was these ordinary men and ordinary women saying, you know what? We can't do this on our own. Things will just go against us. We'll fail if it's just us against the world. And so they remembered what Jesus said. I'm going to send to you another one like me, another comforter, another counselor, just like I am comforting and counseling to you. And so even though they couldn't see God, they prayed and they trusted him. Now, Peter and John gave their report to the rest of the ordinary people that were there. And the content of the report was this: the world is against us, but God is for us. Now, if this were a marketing report given in a corporate setting, it would have been an anxious boardroom indeed. Our product has high favorables, but also high negatives. We hear this all the time in the run-up to the 2008 election. You know, she's got high favorables. A lot of people love her or him, but also a lot of people don't like her. They feel strongly against her or him. We hear this all the time. And if this were a marketing report, it would have been anxious, an anxiety-ridden atmosphere. But Peter and John and the church had matured since the early days of Jesus' ministry. They were young in the Holy Spirit, but they'd spent some time with Jesus. They'd taken their lumps. And then even remember, after he had been raised from the dead, he spent 40 days with them. Back in the old days, when they'd first started out with Jesus, they were caught up at times in the highs of Jesus' popularity. Jesus, look at all the people following you. Let's take over the world. Let's throw the Romans out of Jerusalem. Let's kick the Jews out of the temple. And when things got tough, the disciples panicked and worried and wanted to fight or run away. But here in this text, we see a different kind of response altogether. They don't panic. As Luke tells it, the young church raised their voices together in prayer to God. Finally, they were understanding. Finally, they were getting it, that their strength was not going to be based on whether they had 120 or 3,000 or 5,000 or whether they were popular or not. Their confidence was going to be determined by the sovereignty of God and by the power of the Holy Spirit working in